Anyway, I'm a clinical psychologist. I wear a lot of hats. I'm more academic these days, although I still see patients part-time because my field of academic interest is pain bioethics, and I wouldn't feel particularly credible being a voice of conscience in pain medicine if I weren't in there with the patients who suffer from pain, in there in the trenches. I'd feel fraudulent if I were purely academic. I'm also now the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Pain Research. We'll talk a little bit about research and how you can use research in order to advocate for yourselves. I can do that. Okay. Okay. Yeah, I'm usually pretty soft-spoken. Anyway, my practice involves making sure that the patients with whom I work get good treatment, because pain treatment in general stinks. I've written that, and I speak about this all the time. I think that, you know, 1% of the people out there who suffer from chronic pain receive what I consider adequate treatment. I am doing some more lecturing in Europe now. When I get up there on the stage and I lecture, they laugh at us, because certain things don't mix, such as capitalism and pain medicine, but that's another lecture for another time. You know, some things are not fungible. Some things are fundamental human rights. My belief is good pain care is a fundamental human right. So I spend lots of time. If I do a 20-hour-a-week practice, I'm spending about 7 of those hours on an unpaid basis doing advocacy work for my patients, greasing the wheels, getting things done for them. Unfortunately, my partner and I are the only trained pain psychologists in the state in practice at all, so we're the only ones doing that. And for the vast majority, 99.9% of people who have chronic pain, it's a luxury that they can't access. And accordingly, what I want to talk about is how you can be your own best advocate. It would be nice if you had professional advocates around, but we're hard to find. Doesn't pay well, but we'll be talking about that too. So I'm going to be talking a lot about vulnerability, and I write a lot about vulnerability because all patients who have medical and or psychological illnesses are in a vulnerable position, and our system of treatment and the dollar-driven treatment in chronic pain is something that makes people even more vulnerable. So I've written that, again, you are the most vulnerable of all people. One of the reasons is that chronic pain is not just a physical experience, but something that's also going to have its emotional experiences associated with it. And when you have the double whammy, you're particularly vulnerable. So my question, do vulnerable populations deserve advocacy? Well, theoretically, yes. And if we go back to the ancient Greeks and the ancient Romans, there's a lot of talk about the physician being the advocate for the patient. But unfortunately, it's only on a theoretical basis at this point. It really, in my eyes, just rarely happens these days. So what makes patients with pain so vulnerable? Well, pain itself, for starters. Gene Jackson wrote, and I love this quote, "Pain is a deeply disturbing subject, in part because it is associated with other deeply disturbing, negatively valued subjects, such as disability, ugliness, death, weakness, and failure." And Gene only captured a piece of it, but still, it's a lovely quote. So back in 2001, my colleague in New York, Alan Leibowitz, wrote about the particular vulnerability of people who have pain. Well, for one thing, it's often incurable. Okay, we talk about pain management. When it comes to chronic pain, it's rare that the patient is actually cured, as we consider cured in American medicine. Chronic pain is associated with higher levels of depression and anxiety. It's often associated with end-of-life issues, the use of unproven treatments, which I do a lot of writing on, and I'll be talking a little bit about that. Increasing economic pressures on pain clinics, and we'll be talking about pain clinics because they've gone away, but when Alan was writing this back in 2001, we still had about 1,000 in this country. And also, many people with chronic pain are involved in personal injury litigation or the workers' compensation systems, which are really just a mess. So he wrote that 13 years ago, and you know, it's only gotten worse. So what we decided to do, or we were invited to do, is 2011 and 2012 to do a one-year special series in the journal Pain Medicine, which is the American Academy of Pain Medicine's journal, on the transformation of the profession of pain medicine to the business of pain medicine. And boy, we pissed a lot of people off. Oh well. So what came out of it, the different articles, because there are about a dozen articles. Number one, health insurance industry is becoming more and more egregious. My colleague Salima Magani at Penn talked about increased corporatization of pain medicine results in more racial and ethnic disparities in care. So, you know, if you are of a minority status beyond the, chronic pain isn't even a minority, it's getting close to being a majority, based on the Institute of Medicine report, but if you're a minority, corporatization is really taking us back a long, long way in a bad place. Mary Lou Taylor discussed the idea that profits of business now trump the well-being of patients with pain. Ron Coolidge and John Lozier, two of the great pain bioethicists, both have been around for a long, long time, talked about the present mirrors antiquity. Back in the old days, it was the wealthy that got treatment for their ailments. And now it's the very wealthy and very entitled that are able to get that high level of pain treatment that is available, again, to a very small minority in this country. Not only is the evidence basis in pain medicine not followed, but there are plenty of efforts to intentionally suppress the evidence basis so that more profits can be made. And we coined the term the medical industrial complex. Jerome Schafferman in California and I have done a lot of work with this. And we look at conflict of interest in pain societies. And I'm very involved with the American Pain Society, American Academy of Pain Medicine, present every year, American Society of Pain Educators. But there are conflicts of interest in pain societies. And the bias and misinformation that is presented in many cases results in poor and sometimes deadly treatment. For example, for years and years, pain societies are saying, opioids are God's gift to everyone and everyone ought to have as much as they want. There's no dangers. Misinformation. Then we have physician complicity, which Dr. Leibowitz wrote about, and that is, well, hell, if industry is getting rich from patients with chronic pain, why shouldn't I? And that, unfortunately, has become the goal of certain physicians. Other bad developments, increased stigmatization. With the opioid abuse crisis came more stigmatization of people with chronic pain. Mitch Cohn and colleagues refer to as the extinction of empathy. Also, my big issue is the demise of interdisciplinary pain management programs in the United States. I spent 16 years developing and running an interdisciplinary clinic in Pennsylvania before moving out west. And back in 1999, we had about 1,000 of them in this country. Now, how many we have now outside the VA system? About 70, half of which are in Texas. So in Washington, if you have chronic pain, you can't go to the interdisciplinary pain clinic, which has the highest level of evidence basis, the lowest iatrogenic complications, and incredible cost effectiveness, simply because insurance won't pay for it, and hospitals are not willing to take any kind of loss. So they've gone away. So I wrote an article in Pain Clinical Updates in 2012 looking at all the European nations and Australia and New Zealand where they have national health services, and they're building plenty of these clinics because these countries own the patient's health care for life, and they see how cost-effective they are. So the graph shows all the European nations going up, and we go down because industry is making the decisions. And then the war on opioids, their manufacturers, the physicians who write for them, patients who need them. My friend Barry Cole, some of you may know of, coined the term narco-terrorism. And it's sort of like anyone who's dealing with opioids is terrorized. So what's next for patients with pain? Okay? As long as pain medicine is a business rather than a profession, in the true sense of the word, patients with pain will become progressively more vulnerable. Who's going to advocate? Who will advocate for you? Some pain societies take patient advocacy seriously. Others are merely self-serving. I will not name names because I'm on too many boards. And then, you know, we put together the ethics forum in pain medicine that Beth Darnell at Stanford and I do every other month, and we talk about these issues of advocacy and taking care of the well-being of patients. But great, you know, 2,000-3,000 people, all academicians around the world, read the journal Pain Medicine, so we're preaching to the choir. You know, so even those of us who are trying on a macro level, sometimes, you know, great, everyone in academia knows that pain care stinks. Then we have pain patient advocacy groups, and I'll refer to this as the good, the bad, and the ugly. Okay? What are the good? I like the power of pain. Okay? What does the power of pain do? For one thing, you work on a macro and a micro level, meaning societal, sometimes individual, emphasizing community action to help patients with neuropathic pain syndromes. It's good stuff. Another foundation where I'm real involved is the U.S. Pain Foundation with Paul Galeno, a friend of Barbie and Ken's, and they're extremely effective in their policy initiatives to bring about legislation that tries to level the playing field for vulnerable patients. And in terms of getting legislation passed, particularly in the Northeast states, so that insurance companies can't make you go through 5 failed trials of generic meds before going to the med that is prescribed by your doc, they've been very, very effective. So they're doing some good things. The American Chronic Pain Association emphasizes education for patients with pain. They do nice work. And Partners Against Pain are heavily educational focused. Their website addresses education for both patients and providers. So these are good groups. My concern is that resources are limited, and for the most part, the focus is on the macro issues, and there's not enough resources for directly impacting the vulnerable individual. So this is not a bust on you, just resources are limited, and if you had 1,000 Barbie and Kens out there, then all would be good. Then we've got the bad. So how does Michael define the bad? Any group that sees patient advocacy as synonymous with advocacy to access to opioids, I think is bad. Am I anti-opioid? Heck no. I work as a consultant to Mallinckrodt, Zogenix, okay? I'm middle of the road. But some of these pain advocacy groups are merely, you know, I don't care about your person with pain, I care that my people with pain get opioids, because that's what we're paid to say. They tend to be heavily industry funded. The one exception, and this is real controversial, is a group called PROMPT. Jeff Feuden runs it, and it's Professionals for Rational Opioid Monitoring and Pharmacotherapy. So what you read about in the paper is a group called PROP, Physicians for Responsible Opioid Prescribing, and they are a zealot group. And they are anti-opioid in any case. And I work with these people. I wrote an article with Jeff Feuden in my journal recently, and they're now no longer head. Andrew Kolodny had, you know, was threatening to go to council about it and wanted me to retract the article, and I'm saying, nah, not going to happen. So what Jeff Feuden, who's middle of the road like me, he put together a group called PROMPT, and what PROMPT does is presents scientifically based evidence rather than being politically based, and that's important. And then there's the ugly. American Pain Foundation, real quickly, they described it themselves as the nation's largest advocacy group for pain patients. They're receiving well over 90% of their funding from pharma and the implantable device industry, and they mirrored pharma and the implantable device industry's positions. And they're bringing in millions and millions. Now, some of you heard about the Baucus-Grassley investigation, two senators. 2012 said, hey, we have an opioid crisis, and these groups and these individuals were really involved in causing the overprescription of opioids. And they targeted, among many others, the American Pain Foundation. And it was really curious that they shut their doors the very day that the investigation was announced, citing irreparable economic circumstances, meaning they didn't want to go to jail. So that's kind of ugly. So we're going to talk about advocacy for the individual, okay? Again, it goes back to the ancient Greeks. Hippocrates talked about this 2,500 years ago. This is not a new notion. And physicians are taught and expected to advocate. And a piece came out, The Skills for the New Millennium, report of the Societal Needs Working Group, and they identified 7 major physician roles, and health advocacy was one of them. And Lee has written a lot about this and notes that it's logical to expand the advocacy role of the physician from health advocate to patient advocate. And also, and I love what he writes, the physician is an advocate, a defender of the individual patient and of society against forces that threaten health, such as domestic violence and physical abuse. The physician is a mediator, an intercessor who protects the patient against adversity and helps the patient access needed support services. All sounds good, but my patients come to me and they say, I went and saw the doctor. Every time I opened my mouth, he told me, not now. He won't listen. He won't answer questions. That's a long way from advocacy. So what's happened? Well, again, as I pointed out, and will continue to point out, pain medicine has become increasingly mercenary. Time is money, is the philosophy out there. And treating the patient with pain biopsychosocially as a whole entity, we know it's more effective, but it's less remunerative than a specialization and running a block shop. So I will have an interview next week at a major university's medical school to discuss how to clean up their pain clinic. And unfortunately, as long as you're giving a lot of injections and not spending time talking to patients, they're making a lot of money. And the bean counters that run the hospital are none too excited about that. So I think it's going to be a very short marriage. Advocating for patients is certainly time-consuming. So who are the players in pain management? It used to be the patients and the physicians or other providers. So I use the word physicians, that may include psychologists or occupational and physical therapists, just kind of getting to the ancient Greek stuff here. And that was once and for a long time considered a sacred dyad, meaning that the patient and his or her physician ought to be making the decisions. So if anyone knows about Asclepios, he was the ultimate physician hero in ancient Greek and Roman mythology and medical traditions. And he was the hero because not only was he a healer, but he was a helper. And he was almost a god. It's a little bit unclear when you read the mythology. But he couldn't have been a god because he had to work for a living. So I don't think gods work for a living. Well, again, that was not meant to sound as offensive. It may have. The ancient Roman and Greek gods. So now the players in pain medicine include lots of folks, the insurance industry, the hospital industry, the pharmaceutical industry, the medical device industry, the urine drug testing industry. Notice how the word industry comes after all of them? Attorneys, the government, and I'm not talking about Obamacare, I'm talking about the DEA making decisions, state medical boards making the decisions about how you as a patient are treated by your physician, and certainly the media. And the media has perpetrated what Dr. Fuden and I refer to as neuromysticism, creating all these myths about opioids being bad all the time and counting every death and never paying attention to the success stories that I have seen so many of in my career. No wonder you all feel vulnerable. Heck, I feel vulnerable just talking about it. I feel vulnerable just practicing. And I certainly feel vulnerable lecturing. At Pain Week, where I lecture every year for the last 9 years, rumor was that the DEA was around. And not only were they going to bust on the docs who were prescribing, but those of us who advocate for consideration of opioids would be busted on too. So far we haven't been busted, and that was back in September. Eventually I'll be in jail. Barbie will bake me a cake. So you really want to be vulnerable? Trust. It is misguided. So what do we do? There's not the advocates out there. Let's talk about how we advocate for ourselves. Number one, first and foremost, advocating against the health insurance industry. Okay? The goal of health insurance industry is not your well-being. The goal of the health insurance industry is purely cost containment and profitability. Be prepared to meet with frustration tactics as they actually teach their employees frustration tactics. Statements such as, our policy is, as soon as they start with that, I finish a sentence, our policy is arbitrary. I piss off a lot of people. So recently, Stemple, not that recently, 5 years ago, talked about claims managers. I don't know if we have any claims managers in the audience. If I do, I'm just quoting Stemple, but refer to the work as low-budget drudgery, and claims managers oftentimes have chips on their shoulders. And this is, I think, often worse in cases of personal injury and workers' comp, which is a lot of my practice. But at least then you may have an attorney, although, as we'll talk about in a little bit, that's not always a blessing. You've got to know what your policy covers and doesn't. Policies are tricky, and people go get services that aren't covered and are left with huge bills. Know what you have to do regarding pre-approval. It's amazing how many people say, oh, no, I'm sure this is covered. Ding, $2,500 bill later. Oh, didn't get pre-approval. Well, it was reasonable and necessary, but you didn't get approval. You have to pay. Know the out-of-pocket costs for out-of-network providers, because progressively more physicians are pulling a Nancy Reagan and just saying no to health insurance. So the head of labor and industry in the state of Washington, Dr. Gary Franklin, says, Michael, why can't we get good mental health people involved? And I say, because you're a pain in the ass to work with. Why don't you get some of your buddies to join on with workers' compensation? They're my buddies. I wouldn't do that to them. Document, document, document. Time, the date, and the person you spoke with, and write a brief summary of the conversation. Very importantly, do not be afraid to ask your physician for a letter of medical necessity, because it looks real bad when they have a letter of medical necessity and they don't approve of the service. The worst that your physician can do, if you ask, is say no. And when that happens, maybe it's time to pick a new physician. Because I have physicians who say, Michael, I need to get a letter of medical necessity out. Will you ghostwrite it for me? And it takes me about 4.5 minutes. I email to them. They put it on their letterhead. Out it goes. It's not a hard process. Also, states vary in terms of their insurance laws. And having practiced in a number of different states and trained in a number of different states, I see a lot of variance. So you go to your state insurance commission, because some states actually allow your claims to be reviewed by external organizations. I don't know about Arizona, but that's a really good thing. This is very controversial. Do not be afraid to ask your physician to change your diagnosis. They'll pay for certain things, they won't pay for others. And we know that many pain diagnoses are arbitrary. And so are the insurance decisions to reject or accept a claim. So when you figure out what they will pay for, go to your doc and say, diagnose me with this. I mean, you know, if you go in there with a, you know, a strained low back and you say, you know, tell them I've got end-stage cancer and beriberi, I mean, that's a little bit extreme. But for a long time, they wouldn't pay for a fibromyalgia diagnosis. Okay? Anyone who has TMJ pain, okay, move that around. Have your doctor move around. Your doctor should be savvy enough to know what's covered and what's not covered. If you have chronic pain, and if you can afford to do so, avoid these high deductible limited benefit plans, because paying more now will mean greater access to treatment later. As I said, physicians are dropping out of insurance plans, and they're definitely dropping out of the ones that have high deductions and limited benefits. Avoid HMOs at all costs. They tend to be a lot more egregious than our other commercial carriers regarding coverage. The good news is that over the last 15 years or so, HMO enrollment as a percentage of all those who have health insurance has decreased by over half. So they're on their way out, thank God. So we'll talk about hospitals. Hospitals, along with the insurance companies, are the cause of the demise of interdisciplinary pain management in the United States. Now, I was able to keep my program going, and it's still going because we hit it within the anesthesiology cost center. And it loses money every year, but the needle jocks are making enough money that the center as a whole is looking profitable. So they're able to provide interdisciplinary pain management. Most hospitals are too smart for that, and they just shut them down. Again, hospitals, like insurance companies, are becoming progressively more mercenary, and that's not of any help to you. Also, the distinction between not-for-profit and for-profit hospitals has essentially eroded. Now, recently we've seen this trend of not-for-profits converting to for-profit status. And the propaganda for a while was that for-profit organizations are going to be run more efficiently and they're more clinically effective on critical dimensions. But a very recent study in JAMA pointed out that this kind of conversion from not-for-profit to for-profit makes hospitals indeed more profitable. Great, but does not affect the quality of care or hospital mortality rates. So again, who's being helped here? This is not being done for patients. Also, we have the recent trends towards hidden costs that insurers are refusing to cover. Big one is facility fees. And I struggle with that every time I take my son to see his doctor at the big hospital where they have a great pediatrics department. But they've got some other things going on. Double billing for two procedures during the same surgery. One of my favorites, room and board, all inclusive, for outpatient services. We see that? Thermal therapy, that's a bag of ice or a blanket. But my very favorite is a disposable mucus recovery system, also known as a tissue, for which some hospitals are actually charging at this point. Isn't that beautiful? Disposable mucus recovery system. Doesn't that roll off your tongue? That's beautiful. And then the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal did a couple of articles on drive-by doctoring, meaning that you're having a surgery, and the surgeon says, yeah, I'll do the surgery, knocks you out, does a surgery, and then you get a bill from another surgeon. Who was in there? That's my golfing buddy. He had nothing to do that day, so he came in too. So he's going to send you a separate bill. So, you know, a high-priced plastic surgeon performed the, you know, delicate sutures for your hemorrhoidectomy. Who really cares what your sutures look like if you're having a hemorrhoidectomy? My father was a colorectal surgeon, true story, back east. And I used to play a lot of hockey as a kid, and I'd ding myself up, and he'd suture me up at the kitchen table. And my mother would be, oh, he's going to look like Frankenstein's monster. And my father would be, oh, why do sutures no one really ever notices? You know, great. That's why I look like I do. So I think it was Forbes put out 6 tips for fighting bills from a hospital. Get organized. Keep good records of services and goods received. Vigilantly review all bills so they're not throwing stuff in there that didn't happen. Negotiate bills, and this is super effective. You tell them, I can't pay this. Well, we'll send you to collection. Okay. I still won't get paid. I think I can pay half the bill, but that's about all I can pay. Oh, nope, you have to pay it all. Okay, then put me on a payment plan where I'll pay $10 a month. And they can't refuse that. You'd be amazed at how quickly they are going to take that $1,000 rather than the $2,000 as opposed to waiting 200 months. Consider hiring a new trade, a medical bill advocate. Yeah, they'll save you money. They'll take 20 to 30% of what they save you. But that means 70 to 80% of what they save goes into your pocket. See if you're eligible for hospital financial aid. Tend to see this a lot in religious-based hospitals. Not too many hospitals, but a lot of Catholic hospitals will have this type of program. And explore alternative fundraising. Big one is GoForward.com, where I've had patients go on after having expensive surgeries when they're not insured, and they get charitable donations that come in and help pay. So this was in Forbes last year, and I kind of like this list. The pharma industry. Let's move around here. Okay, now pharma companies have been much maligned for their pricing and their marketing and data suppression transgressions of the past. Okay, they goofed up. Pharma did some bad things over the years. And they've been heavily indicted, well, heavily by me as well as others, for causing the prescription drug crisis in America. You know, oh, this medication is not addictive. I won't mention it by name, but it became, you know, they had to reformulate it in 2010, and it's a lot less of a problem now. But we have to remember, you know, from the research end of things, which I've become involved with, the research and development costs are astronomical, costing billions of dollars to get a new drug out there. Not millions, but billions of dollars. in many cases. And it's been posited by a lot of people, and I will echo that, that pharma is making an effort overall to clean itself up. The bottom line, though, is many of the best medications for pain are still expensive. Pfizer was generous enough to be a sponsor of this program, and they make one of the great medications, maybe the greatest, for neuropathic pain in pregabalin, in Lyrica. And I have to fight and fight and fight with the insurance companies to pay for it. Much more tolerable than the alternative, but it's expensive. But how much did Pfizer spend in getting it out to market? Billions of dollars. What we've called for regarding opioids is that, you know, before hydrocodone became Schedule 2 and it was Schedule 3, Beth Darnell, my writing partner at Stanford, we put out a brief article saying, here's the answer. If it is a tamper-resistant formulation or an abuse-deterrent formulation, pretty much the same thing, let's make it a Schedule 3 because it, in and by itself, is already safer. And then if it's not, make it a Schedule 2. And even though we're trying to protect patients' rights to good opioid medications when they need them, we realize that our call could potentially perpetuate the cost crisis. So the bottom line is health insurance calls the shots regarding which medications they'll cover, and that just shouldn't be anymore. And pharma is actually trying to help. Now, this is a list of a lot of different companies that make medications that are routinely used to treat chronic pain. And each of them has a patient assistance program. And I get my patients on them all the time. You can go to www.rxassist.org. And this is a pretty big list with some of the big players: Allergan, Depomed, Endo, Forest, GlaxoSmithKline, J&J, Lilly, Mallinckrodt, Merck, Pfizer, Purdue, Reckitt-Benckiser, Teva, Zogenix. If it ain't made by one of them, you probably don't need it. But on a serious note, these companies all are willing to help out. And I've had patients get the one-year scholarship and then have it renewed for another year and then get up on their feet and get to work and get insurance, you know. And some people have likened it to the, you know, heroin dealer saying, here, I'll give you a little taste, try this, and then you're hooked for life. But I think that the companies that do these types of programs are actually more altruistic than that. Implantable devices, okay, two types primarily used in chronic pain: spinal cord stimulators and intrathecal opioid pumps. Understand the evidence basis. You have to educate yourselves, or at least ask for the education. Okay, spinal cord stimulators for years have been implanted because docs make a lot of money doing them, and the companies that make them make a lot of money selling them. And they've been used for the wrong causes because they're a lot more effective for neuropathic pain than nociceptive pain, although some really cool stuff is starting to come out on what they call high-frequency burst stimulation for nociceptive pain. So if you have back pain and leg pain, they'll give you a pump. It'll help with the leg pain. But this high-burst stimulation stuff is very, very cool. Again, I have no involvement with this on any sort of level other than reading the articles, but it really is exciting. Ask the rep. If any of you has had an implantable device put in, it's the doctor, you, and a rep from the company. So ask for a systematic review supporting the use of a spinal cord stimulator for your specific condition. Okay? Make sure that the review is done independently, not by docs on the spinal cord stimulator manufacturer payroll, which is so often the case. And the difference between a systematic review and a research article, and I think it was Mark Twain, said there's three kind of lies, damn lies, and statistics. And I, you know, get articles put in front of me all the time and say, well, this is kind of a stinky study. But if they say, well, this is evidence that. But a systematic review is a specific methodology where you look at the whole body of literature, experts are analyzing the research, and they throw out the bad studies, and they include the good studies, and then they draw conclusions. So evidence basis is not based on a single study or a couple of studies. It's based on a systematic review. So ask your doc and ask the rep for systematic reviews. We have to remember that bias can exist in these reviews, and, you know, especially ones that are done by people on the payroll. And we also have to remember that implantable device reps can be aggressive as they work on commission. And I've seen them in the office because I've gone to you know, with my patients to see their docs and the rep. And, you know, I've said, show me one bit of evidence that this is going to work. Yeah, but we've tried everything else, so it ought to be done. Why don't we just slice you open and put something inside you that's jolting with electricity? You know, maybe it'll make you happier too. Well, there's no evidence for it, exactly. Intrathecal opioid pumps, there's some serious problems. We just put out an article with people who run pain at some, you know, John Lozier, who ran pain at University of Washington, and Tim Deere, head of the Neuromodulation Society, who has put more pumps in people. But, you know, there's serious problems with efficacy, complications, and mortality. Again, ask the rep and your physician for a systematic review that's truly independent. Ask your physician if he or she is on the device manufacturer's payroll, because kickbacks are rampant. I've seen them happen. Urine drug testing. Has anyone here been urine drug tested? Okay. It's widely considered an important tool in opioid risk mitigation, which is what I run around teaching, and can potentially save lives if done right. Although it has some critics recently regarding efficacy and the potential to interfere with the physician-patient relationship. And it can be and should be done in a sensitive manner, and then the relationship with the doc is protected. But it can be abused by providers and urine drug testing companies. And I was down at UCLA lecturing back in 2008, 2009, and talked about, they can't stop the big payments. Well, they can stop the big payments. And the doctor stood up and said, they're taking away my last piece of candy. Okay? So patients with no history of aberrancy or misuse or drug addiction should not be tested every month. Ask your physician why testing is being done so frequently. Scrutinize your bill closely. Make sure that the provider is not engaging in what's referred to as unbundling. So you pee in the cup, and he's testing for a dozen substances. And the whole thing takes just minutes. So instead of charging the $20 for one test, which is what the law calls for, they're saying 12 times 20 is $240. And this is making the insurance industry mad, and they're going to stop paying. And that's going to be a problem. Avoid continued treatment by physicians who test too aggressively because they're using urine drug testing to make money, not to save lives. Finally, advocating against your own attorney. Why would you do that? Well, one of the journals I edit is Psychological Injury and Law. And personal injury attorneys can, not all times, but they can be unscrupulous and lazy. Some of the problems, poor communication with clients, threatening the integrity of the health care provider-patient relationship, don't listen to him, use of scare tactics to encourage settlement versus taking a case to trial. I've seen collusion with defense counsel, which is a horrific mess. Encouraging inflation of medical expenses. Yeah, have that procedure done, because we're going to multiply this by this, and that's how much we're going to ask for. Well, Mr. Attorney, why don't you have that procedure done? I don't want that thing shoved into me. Also, settling cases without inclusion for future medical coverage. You can ask for inclusion of medical coverage, but you can get more money if you go without medical coverage. But the deal is, a third of that's going to the attorney, so he's going to want the more money option in many cases, and refusal to release legal files following termination. So a lot of abominations do occur. So the strategies for self-advocacy, fire the offending attorney. Let your new attorney fight with the old one, and file a formal complaint with the Bar Association, because that makes them really nervous. Finally, we're going to talk about advocating with physicians. So there's some issues around pain physician motivation. And this includes autonomy versus paternalism, shared decision-making. Is a physician just talking or also listening? Is a physician following an evidence basis? And what's more important to the doc, relief of your suffering or financial remuneration? So how much say do you have in dictating your treatment? Well, a lot of people say, well, how much say should patients have? But we have to respect patient autonomy, and that is the patient's right to choose what treatments you receive or don't receive. And many believe that's a cornerstone of the ethical practice of medicine in general, not just bioethics. It's dependent upon the doctrine of informed consent, meaning the doctor needs to tell you about the potential risks and benefits in a way that you understand, not throwing a bunch of jargon out, but, doc, break it down to me in English. And this is not new stuff. It goes back to Plato and Hippocrates, and they're older than I am. American Medical Association says that physicians are responsible to help patients make choices from among therapeutic alternatives. And that means all therapeutic alternatives, not just the one that's in the best interest of the physician. So pain medicine is unique in that the potential danger of opioids to society, as well as the individual patient, necessitates a more paternalistic approach. Can't say, well, if you want all the opioids you can swallow, here, I'm going to give it to you. Choice is yours. Okay? Physicians have to protect their patients and society. Yet the physician does not always know best. So on most dimensions of care, a shared decision-making approach is optimal. You have the right to be involved in your own care. You're the one who's hurting. You have that right. It's considered the pinnacle of patient-centered care. It improves outcomes, reduces costs. It's particularly important in what we call preference-sensitive conditions, such as chronic pain, where treatments are usually elective. So there's no clear-cut answer in most cases of chronic pain, and it needs to be a matter of discussion, back and forth. It's a more time-consuming model than the traditional paternalistic model, where the doctor's Tarzan and you're Jane. But it's also associated with better patient adherence and better patient satisfaction. So be assertive in requesting shared decision-making. Tell your doc that you want to be part of this. You have the right to change providers. Last one we'll talk about would be listening. Again, associated with patient satisfaction, enhances outcomes. And it's critical for gathering clinical information, diagnoses, choice of therapeutic interventions. And according to Jay Jagosh, listening in and by itself, I think, is real important because it's a healing and therapeutic intervention. Sometimes just to be heard feels really good. Failure to listen is associated with treatment avoidance. Make sure your doc's making eye contact with you, because if you're not making eye contact with me, I'm not going to believe you. Of particular importance in cases of medically unexplained symptoms, and you know, chronic pain oftentimes is medically unexplainable. So if a physician is too rushed to listen to you, consider another physician, because that person's not managing his or her practice particularly well. Okay? So evidence basis, we tend to focus on patient adherence. What about practitioner non-adherence? There are guidelines for the treatment of pain out there. How well are they followed? Okay. Physical therapy guidelines are out there. They're associated with better and lower costs, or better outcomes, lower costs, but they're often not followed. Primary care docs found not to adhere particularly well to acute low back pain treatment guidelines. Same with specialists. Cancer pain management guidelines, a study done by Stu DePen, shows that they're very effective. Yet a recent review shows that the adherence with these guidelines is still insufficient. So chronic non-cancer pain guidelines exist, yet they're so inconsistent that I think a lot of the docs are lost. For example, there's the American Pain Society, AAPM, joint guidelines on opioid treatment and chronic pain, but how well are practitioners actually complying with these guidelines? Not particularly well. You have the right to ask your provider for a reference supporting recommended treatment and ask for a reference, as I said, to a systematic review rather than an individual study. Learn to use Google Scholar. Learn where to put the quotation marks because you can find the systematic reviews. And get a second opinion if the evidence is dubious. Is it about money or love? Obviously, it should be about love. But much of the evidence-based pain treatment that we see out there, it's about financial gain. Be wary of the tests and procedures ordered in physician-owned facilities. Ask docs about their relationships with urine drug testing companies if they're over-testing. Again, second opinions need to be your friends. So in conclusion, it's not easy to suffer from chronic pain. And I'm not saying, you know, buck up, guys. It's hard. For a variety of reasons, patients with pain are extremely vulnerable. Unfortunately, our system has turned pain treatment not as a business, but turned into a profession, but just into a mere business. Unfortunately, there's too many players in the pool. The waters have gotten very muddied. Providers who will serve as advocates are becoming very few and far between. The informed patient and the assertive patient with pain is going to be the most satisfied one. Do not offend, or do not fear being offensive. I'm plenty offensive. But as patients, don't fear being offensive to insurers, hospitals, attorneys, even physicians, because your pain experience will improve once you begin to advocate effectively for yourselves. Thank you.